Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, welcome. I am Ken Reed. This is TV Guidance Counselor, the show in which I discuss classic television with people who made it, were on it, and watched it, using back issues of TV Guide magazine as our doorways into the memories of our collective past. You may hear beeping in the background, or a squeaking, rather. That is the puppy, Larry. I had to give him a toy to get him to leave me alone long enough to record this intro and outro, so pay no mind to that. I am not covering the murder of a clown or anything that squeaks that I would want to pretend was a puppy eating a toy, and stop asking me questions about it. Anyway, my guest this week is Yancy Butler, and I love talking to Yancy. You probably best know her from maybe Witchblade or Brooklyn South. She was also in Dropzone and in Hard Target. We talk about all those things here. Mann and Machine, a ton of things. Great actor, fascinating person, really funny. Just love talking to her. So, and I think you will love hearing me talk to her. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Yancy Butler.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Yancy Butler, how are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me, Ken.
Oh, thanks for doing this.
Thanks.
I'm a great fan of your work, so it's nice
to
chat about this. You've trekked out to our Airbnb here.
This is gorgeous.
It's very fancy.
It is very fancy. I like it, and I like the way they decorated it very much.
It's funny because we every time we talk about moving out here, we realize that our frame of reference is when we come out and rent an Airbnb and live like people who are much wealthier than we are.
Right. So the land of the beautiful and, the beautiful and rich, as my father calls it. So
not how we would do this.
Yes. Although I love Boston. I love Boston.
Have you spent a lot of time there?
You know what? I haven't. I've spent less time than I would like. I went on my, I went to Sarah Lawrence College, and I always like to give a shout out to them, but on my junior break, I took spring break where everybody's like going down to, you know. Exactly. Yeah. I was girl gone wild, but not even. I went to Boston for a couple of days and stayed in a bed and breakfast and went around to all the museums and stuff like that. I just love Boston.
It's weird because it's weird when I started traveling outside of Boston. There are various things that I realize are not normal for a lot of people. Like the thing I always joke about on stage is that people's opening argument in an altercation or a misunderstanding is not to just punch someone. But it's a very Boston thing.
Unlike New York City, where I grew up.
It's just like headbutts.
Punch first, never apologize, never explain. Exactly. You're not supposed to punch somebody.
But the history piece, which New York's the same way, where you're like, this is a graveyard from 1640.
I know.
Like Texas, and they're like, this is the oldest thing here. It's from 1971.
Exactly. That's kind of like the way the California is. I mean, we have some of the houses are older, but not one for.
But it's cool mid-century stuff, though. Like it'll be cool 50s.
Yes, retro, if you will. Yeah, I dig it.
It's like Eastern Bloc brutalism.
I know. It's
just architecture, you know.
It's true. Well, when you live someplace and you work someplace, it's hard to. I don't get to see a lot of where I work. Right. You know, I'll go to speaking of Eastern Europe, I'll go to Bulgaria now and do a bunch of films, and I don't get to see anything. People are like, "How's Bulgaria?" And I'm like, "The inside of the sound studio was great because I never get to." Yeah, the stage was great.
It looked like a pirate ship.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And so I don't get to see much of where I'm working. But
well, you grew up right in Manhattan, right?
I did, indeed, in the West Village. Yeah,
70s.
And born and raised. Yes.
I used to be terrified of New York in that era because of the Warriors.
Oh my gosh, the Warriors was like, come out and play, yay. That was the scariest. As a matter of fact, I had a baseball jacket custom made that had Warriors on the back at like 13 years old. Yeah.
In New York.
Yes. That movie I have seen. Yes.
But that I'm like, that's what New York must be like.
I know.
Which I imagine.
Do not enter. Yeah. No, it was great. It was a little bit of that, but it was more kind of loosey-goosey back then, you know, because people were still in the hippie era and hipped out and stuff. But growing up was quick. there, yeah, to say the least.
Yeah,
to say the least.
Street smart.
To, yeah, very much so. Well, as my parents always said, the quicker you can steer yourself away from the crazy people, the better. Yes. Now, they did that at a little too young an age, but you do learn how to steer yourself away from the crazy people. But in New York, they'll tell you straight up, like, I'm crazy.
Yes.
You know, whereas here, it's more subtle.
I just want you to know.
Yeah, it's a little, crazy. Yes, yes, right? exactly.
Yeah, it's... I hear tales of my friends who grew up there. Like, yeah. Like a friend of mine grew up in Greenwich Village-ish.
Yeah, that's where I grew up. Oh, like
Al Lewis used to have a restaurant there, Grandpa Munster.
Yes, 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 he did. It was a great restaurant.
And he used to just sit out front the whole time. Or yeah. Just hanging out.
Yeah. Yeah, right. he did. I actually saw him there.
That's really weird.
Yeah, I know.
And, like, I remember when I was a teenager, I was in a punk band, and we played in...
Oh, that's awesome.
Albany or something.
Uh-huh.
And Al Lewis was running for governor of New York.
Was he? It wouldn't surprise me.
And so we played
Grandpa
the show.
Grandpa for governor.
Yeah.
It's a nice campaign.
That might have actually been his campaign,
If it was me, it would have definitely been
I would have definitely
campaign.
Done that.
Yeah.
And he... Munster for mayor. I mean, there's so that's many right. things he could have done.
So much for alliteration.
Yeah,
yes.
Exactly. And that's how you win campaigns.
Yes, that's
and
right.
It was a long story. We were supposed to play this club, and we showed up, and they were literally locking the doors with like a chain because it was being seized or something.
Oh,
and
no.
So we were on tour, so like without playing, we'd have no money to get the next day. It was ridiculous.
That's a sure sign you're not playing.
Yes, absolutely.
When they put a lock on
the door. We actually physically can't in because the sheriff is here seizing this building. So we ended up playing like a pickup show at some restaurant or something. And we had to like pass a hat around for money. And Al Lewis had just like walked in because he was campaigning. So he walks
How
in
random.
With his big cigar and he comes up to me and he goes, "It seemed like nice kids." And he palmed me a $100 bill.
Oh my
gosh.
It was
like the most like I was going to get him a seat at a restaurant.
Now, was that during his campaign? Because was it?
Yeah. And
did you
I should have been. Well, I was in Massachusetts.
Oh, that's true.
I was also under 18.
Maybe he didn't know that.
The only thing you say that, he probably. I should have been like.
Two strikes out for him. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's nice. I wish. No, when I saw him, he did not slip me $100.
Maybe he wasn't running for anything.
Maybe he wasn't. That's right.
That's how you do it.
That's right.
There's a documentary called 1977, The Coolest Year in Hell. That's about New York in 77.
Oh, wow.
And it's amazing. It's about the blackout.
I was just going to say, the blackout, I was just going to say that that's the only thing that I'm aware of at that time.
Blackout, Son of Sam were the same summer.
Oh my gosh, that's right.
Hip hop started that summer.
Which is salacious in itself.
Yeah, I mean, you have
not to not be hip hop, but it's not just not from my cup of tea.
Yeah, but that's when it.
If I could understand what they were, saying a lot of the time. Hip hop, I can. It's rap.
Yes.
But yes.
But you're like, this interesting. Is not for me.
Yes. No, and I would like to see that. That sounds really cool.
It's really good. I think it's online. You could probably check it out. But I'm curious for someone who grew up there and then to see how accurate it is because it fascinates me watching it because it's not quite the Warriors. But
no.
It's not that far. Like some of the people I know grew up in like the Bronx and stuff like that.
Yeah, which is, there are some sketchy places. Well, now it's so expensive to live there that almost all the crime has gone off. I mean,
that's how you do it.
Yeah, and that's
same with Boston. It's all gone to the suburbs.
Isn't that amazing?
They've priced out crime.
Yeah. I think they have. They've gentrified. Yeah.
Yes.
It's really kind of horrible when you think about it because, people are now buying up property in New York City and they don't live there.
Yeah.
So it's like, I was trying to think of the word and I'm a little slow today, but they don't live there so they can, but it's like, I own property in New York
City. Investment.
And I'm sure Boston is the same.
Boston's gotten crazy because we have this big tech boom there and then all the schools.
Wow.
And we lose 30% of our population every summer because it's students. So you end up getting.
I never even thought about that.
It's crazy. Like the summer ghost town. It's really weird. And we get a turnover of new people every 4 years, basically.
Right. Oh, yeah, of course.
Because of all the schools. So
that's right.
You get a lot of people with like rich parents who will buy their kid an apartment for like $800,000.
Right.
And the kid's there for 7 months. And then it's just empty.
And then it's just, isn't that amazing?
Which is crazy. Like, you ever see homeless people? I'm like, couldn't you just let them stay in there for a couple months?
Talk about slipping somebody $100.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, that's the new dollar bill.
But you've been out here for a long time.
Right? I have. I actually moved out here testing for a job.
Yeah.
And for Dick Wolf on Mann and Machine. And I came here with like four pairs of underwear, right? I had like four pairs of underwear and I was going to test for this job. And he was like, "You have the part and we don't have time to send you back." And I was like, "Mom." So I called my mother and we did not buy me an $800,000 apartment. But and I stayed here.
She did send you underwear.
She did. She sent me underwear personally.
Yes.
She came out because I was a little overwhelmed. I was 21.
But you had done Law and Order in New York for him before?
I did Law and Order. It was my very first job. And then I did, for David Frankel, a very short-lived, way too short-lived series called Grapevine. And,
okay.
Yeah. And he wrote and directed that. And so, and then it was on to Mann and Machine. So I kind of, I always kid around that I got shot out of a cannon. And yeah. You know, you can only go, it's like I was the most, quote-unquote, beautifully created, genetically created yeah. robot man's fantasy at 21 years old. You can only go downhill from there. Like yeah. like in a
You've
fast
peaked.
Slope. Yeah, right.
Because yeah. that show was sort of like,
21.
Like in light of T2 having come out the summer
of
before
course.
And RoboCop and,
yes.
and Alien Nation, I think, had just got a TV series at that time. Which was
around
that
time, yeah.
That sort of buddy cop.
Exactly. So I only know that we were up against Murder, She Wrote in like its third season. Like, we didn't have a chance
yeah.
in hell. Really.
Different
but
audience,
yeah, right?
though.
Yeah, just a little.
The
but
grannies
yeah.
are like, I like this future set dystopia with a
yeah.
beautiful robot killing machine.
Yeah, right, exactly. yeah. And it was before its time.
Yeah.
It was a shame. It was really before its time.
It's a cool show. I mean, it's people
yeah.
have uploaded a lot of the episodes and stuff. So it's,
have they?
You,
That's
you can
good
see
to
it.
Know.
But it surprisingly holds up fairly well, which most stuff set in the future doesn't.
I know, it still doesn't,
yeah.
and I don't know why that is.
It's. I think when people try to either there's a really weird balance you have to get where it's either has to be, it either can be too much like now,
yes.
or you're just like this is 1990, like Predator 2,
right? Yeah,
which is yeah. like 1999, and they're like, yeah,
right.
or it's too crazy where like there's flying cars and people's consciousness and diamonds, and it's like this is 2001, yeah. like it's just too
and
much.
Diamond. Yeah,
so you just need like
yeah.
that weird balance, and it strikes it well because I think you know it's set
yeah.
in like a crime world, and it still looks kind of. Even in the future, there'll be like kind of a bad part of town where there's
yeah.
criminals.
I know. And then there's Mork and Mindy. Let's
yes.
let's, you know, not forget that.
Yeah.
Where you take a future element and like put it in present day, which is always, you know.
The fish out of water thing that where you
exactly.
can you can make them sort of childlike and naive,
yes.
but not, you know, it's not an actual child.
Yeah, exactly.
which would be a whole shooting thing.
Yes, right. That would be, that's right. Absolutely.
But I mean, to your point, you know, had you been out here at all before you came out to test?
I had
that?
Been out here. Well, it's when my parents, we had moved out here when I was like, I don't know, 3 years old and lived
okay.
in Venice for a hot minute when my dad was, he was trying to cut an album without the group that he's presently in. And then we all moved back to New York and I'd been there ever since. I came out here like once
yeah.
with a college friend for like a weekend to see like some Al Green concert.
Oh, that's
I know,
good concert.
Random, I know, it was a great concert.
yeah.
And at any age. And no, so I knew nothing. And back then is when we had the Thomas guide. Like, we didn't
yeah.
have, you know, I didn't even have a cell phone.
No one did. They were like in a suitcase.
100 years old. No, so yeah, it was like a suitcase. It was a hardcore weapon back
yeah.
in then.
Oh yeah.
But I was like pulling over on the side of the road and I had to drive myself and I was calling up my mother in New York and I was like, I'm lost. And she's like, we're getting you a cell phone, which was as big as the car itself.
Yeah.
It was like a Flintstone
it.
Phone. Yeah, exactly. I always say that. Crank it in the back. Yeah,
yeah.
exactly. So yeah, it was quite a time.
Especially like so many people I know too who either grew up in New York, like Chris Elliott from
uh-huh.
Get a Life. He grew up in New York, and
yes,
he came out here to do Get a Life in '91. Actually, it was the same
right.
year, and he didn't have a license. Like, he never drove in his
I know,
life.
I know.
He grew up in Manhattan.
I know. Well,
which
most of my friends still don't know how to drive.
Yeah,
they don't know how to operate a vehicle. But I will say this is that I still can't recognize people's cars. You can hit
right.
me with my own car, and I wouldn't recognize
right.
it. Like,
what's the make and model year? No idea.
Not a clue. I mean, we you know I'll. Drive up with friends and go to a restaurant. And they're like, oh, you know, Chris, Jane, and Mary are here. And I'm like,
yeah.
how do you have this information? They're like, their car? And
your
I'm like, oh,
lines.
There's I'm like, yeah. oh, there's that.
Yeah.
And you would think, you know, 27 years later, I would have gotten the skill and fine-honed it. And absolutely not. I have no idea what the car
It's like one of those skills you get as a kid. Like, you get it or you don't. It's like language
exactly.
skills.
Yes, right.
you can learn another
exactly,
language when you're
yes.
a kid easily.
Yes.
But in other cars, you can't.
No, I seriously can barely even recognize my own car.
Have you ever taken the public transportation here?
Yes, I have. And it's absolutely
weird.
Yes, it is weird. Well, being from
yeah,
I'm
that's
sure,
what I'm
and being from Boston,
comparing
it's the same
them.
Thing. Comparatively, it's like it takes too long, and it's. I mean, they've you know made huge leaps and bounds, but it's still sketchy at best.
People don't even know they have it. That's no, the thing. They're like, we have that? Like, yes, you do.
We have a subway and a metro system? That's pretty much how it is.
I always get the opposite. Whenever I go to New York, I used to take the bus down, and it was just miserable, and I'd go do shows. And then I was like, I'm just going to drive from now on.
Right.
But I'm like, even worse. But people are like, you drove down here?
I know,
right? Like, yeah, I got a space right up front. I don't know.
Oh, that in itself, they must have wanted to stone you alive.
It's my only bit of luck. I think I may have a mutant parking ability.
Yeah.
Because whenever I go to New York, I can get a call at the Kojak space right out front.
That's damn.
Every time. And that's it's like right. A free space. And I'm like, I don't know.
The parking gods must really like you. See, we usually have to slip people $100 bills.
Yeah.
Like Grandpa.
Get the Al Lewis space.
Yeah. I slipped him $100 to go park at front.
Park at this restaurant. Yeah, it's like, you seem like a good kid. Parking car. So, but you come from a performing family. Like, do you said your dad was, you know, cutting an album out here, and so your dad was in a band, and I think your mom was a Broadway producer?
Yes. My dad still currently is in the Lovin Spoonful, which unbiasedly is just my favorite group in the world, and they're still a tight band.
Yeah.
They're still a really tight band. They play all the time. He's working collectively more than probably both of us put together, and my mom was a company manager of Broadway shows, and my grandfather was a general manager of those Broadway shows.
Right.
So yeah, it was the last family business they wanted me to go into.
Because they were like, we've seen the sights.
No! Yeah.
Become a doctor.
I know, yes, right. Pretty much. Well, the deal was that I could do whatever I wanted as long as I graduated college. They really wanted me to go to college.
And you went to a good college. So
I did, and I was deemed a scholar, and I still don't know what I want to be when I grow up. I can't believe I chose to do this for... You know why I chose to do this, actually, was I had a bunch of student loans to pay back. Sarah,
I still do.
It's a true story to you. God bless
2029.
You. Where's that 100 now?
Yes.
I just looked at the bill. They were like, happy graduation. And I was like, oh my gosh. Yeah. So that was how it all started. And I was like, I walked into a modeling agency and they told me I was too small. Thank God. They told me I was too short.
Really? And you're like 5'8 or something.
I'm 5'7, yeah. But apparently not tall enough.
Okay.
But hey, you know, which is good. I think I have more of a voice than that, obviously. And then I was like, let me just try this because I studied a little bit, but not even in college. Right. I always knew the value of money, and I was like, for this amount of money, I can't even really study acting at Sarah Lawrence. So I did very minimum, and then, I'm still, again, I'm open for suggestions on anything that I can do when I grow up.
But you were seeing a lot of shows, presumably? Like, were you going to a lot of Broadway stuff?
I was.
Yeah, so you kind of absorbed that
stuff.
It was
almost like my homeroom.
We
went to, every opening night. And, well, my mother was able to leave after intermission and after the house seats were counted, the house tickets and stuff. And so once the tickets were counted, so pretty much after intermission, I went home. So I saw like the first act of every single show, like 152 times.
And there was
who's counting?
Blockbuster show. I mean, you had like Grease was on, probably starting them when they did.
Yeah, my mom did mostly Neil Simon shows, like Brighton
Odd
Beach
Couple
and
or
Odd Couple. Yep. She did and. Yeah. And
Brighton Beach Memories, was Jonathan Silverman in it?
Jonathan. Yeah. I haven't seen him in years, and we were very good friends. Matthew Broderick was originally.
Broderick was
Which was, but all of those guys. Anybody, it was almost like the Law and Order of theater.
Right.
Like anybody who was an actor and a male actor, you know, would either do Law and Order or one of the Neil Simon trilogies. It just happened.
Unless you're Hal Linden, and then
unless, right. Unless you're Grandpa.
Yes,
he did
not
one of the Brighton Brighton Beach.
Law and Order being one of the few things shot in New York. Every stand-up comedian I know, has been a murderer on Law and
Order. That's right. Like, that's right. The nicest guy in the world.
You can murder? Okay, we ran out.
It was funny. A friend of mine one time we're reenacting because that's all you do is you do Law and Orders and God bless that show. It's been my dream. And I know it would be to do an SVU. I would love that.
Yeah.
I would love that show. I don't care. And because they kind of strayed away from the formulaic, you know what I mean? They really have, because they know it's going for a hundred more years.
Whatever they want.
That's a half-life on a shelf. So, so they kind of leave it open-ended, but it's still, there's a crime. You have to solve it at some point. But I love that show.
It's funny how so many of the things you've done are like action or cop things. I mean, because Law and Order, was that the first TV role you had?
That was the very first TV role
I had. Which led right to a regular series.
Yes.
Basically.
Yeah, playing a cop.
Yeah, playing a cop. And then was it Brooklyn South next? Or South Beach was next?
South Beach, Dick Wolf wrote that for me. Say that once. And I was so honored. And that was kind of like La Femme Nikita before its time.
Yeah.
It wasn't kind of like, it was La Femme Nikita before its time.
It was like
time.
A Dirty Dozen kind of like Return of the Criminals.
Yes, very much so. And Patty Darbinville was in it, and John Glover, who, amazing actors.
John Glover is one of those people that everyone would recognize, but probably not. He was in 52 Pickup.
He sure was.
And he's so good in that.
Hey, Sporto, yeah.
Because at first he's really funny.
Yes.
And then he
was creepy.
Terrifying. And he doesn't really do anything different. He's playing it the same way, but
he's a brilliant,
so good.
Brilliant actor. And a dream to know.
Yeah.
He's really great. I think he's back in the city and has been for some time. He's always working.
He was great on that show.
He really was.
And it's sort of different part for him than I was used to seeing.
Very much so.
Well.
Yeah.
I remember they did a TV remake of Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. That he was
Did
in.
They really?
Yeah. And it was...
I would love to see that.
It's pretty good, if I remember correctly.
If he's in it, it's got
to
be great.
He's good in it. It's probably around 90, 89
wow.
or 90.
Wow. I didn't even know that. I'll have to... That seems... I'd love to see that.
It's those TV movies that are kind of... I always call them like the lost history.
Yeah.
Because there's huge actors, big directors, but they don't stream anywhere.
No,
they never
movie
come
of the
out.
Weeks... Well, we don't make them anymore.
No.
Well, we don't make television.
Yeah.
except, you know, reality shows. And I'll tell you, and you probably know this being what you do for work, is that it's the pendulum swung where, you know, the writer strike happened.
Yep.
And then we had to fill those slots. And so we filled it with still scripted reality television. And this... schlock, I will go so far as to say, that is on television. We as a nation started watching this drivel, and it's like, it's just horrible. It defines us as really who we are, and it's
been
unfortunate.
Going for 20 years now.
I know.
That's the craziest thing.
It's been 20 years.
Yeah, well, because I always...
About.
I kind of kick it off like Survivor was kind of the first
that's
hit
exactly,
one,
that's
and
it.
That was 99.
Yeah.
So it's been almost 20 years where now that's the prominent thing, and it's... Yeah.
Well, as my honey always says, it's a you know, the next show, and I probably because we should produce it, so I'm but you know, Honey Boo Boo, Naked and Afraid.
Yeah.
It's gonna be like Honey Boo Boo on an island, naked and afraid,
being hunted. It's like Hard Target.
<That's> right.
It's remake
That's
Hard
right.
Target with Honey
Not
Boo Boo and the Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Yes, right. And God bless Honey Boo Boo. I just
Well, shows have become. One of the
it's
things,
like Hard Target.
I think Lance Hendrickson would hunt Honey Boo Boo.
Who wouldn't?
He may be already.
Most of America would.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's
get your $100 worth of that.
That's true. That's about how much it would cost to hunt Honey Boo Boo, I think.
Right.
She'd do it for
right.
that much.
That's right. I would do it for that much. Are you kidding me?
It's like all the shows became aspirational in that there weren't sort of blue-collar-y shows where they were like – very rich people.
Right.
And fantasy.
Right.
Or they became shows about rich people who we wanted to laugh at failure.
Yes.
Or we wanted shows about poor people who thought they were rich people and we laughed at them for failure.
Right.
It was like, those are the three options.
Right. Or the poor people who are just almost degrade themselves on a, you know, where it's a spectacle. It's just really
it's
bad.
It's desperation.
It's really bad.
And we're just let it is
desperation. That's exactly the word I was looking for.
It's irresponsible. It's not just bad for the producers.
Yeah.
I feel it's irresponsible to make a show based around these people's desperation. And
yes.
I always found it really sad.
Yeah.
People are like, it's so funny. And I'm like, it's
exploitive and horrible.
If you wanted to make that funny, you would write a thing like that and have people play those characters and not actually have these people do that. Who don't know.
I knew somebody who was in a reality show, and I can't say what it was, obviously, but they actually would tell him that the person to pick a fight with one of the other people, and that person knows exactly what is coming down the pike, and other person didn't know.
Yeah,
and it cost a friendship.
Yeah.
Like, it seriously cost a friendship for this person, and it was like, you know,
and they don't care; they just want to. They just want footage.
Of course not.
Yeah.
Well, and the other story that, you know, he was on pain medication and then, you know, was supplied with that. I mean, it's just horrible across the board.
Yeah.
It's just horrible across the board. And it's putting us out of work.
Absolutely.
At the same time. I mean, it's really bad.
And I thought that would break at some point. Because when you look at the first one I remember, which was, I think, 87. And the way they went for that was they did a lot of spectacle shows like Battle of the Network Stars type things,
right?
Which they brought back last year again.
Or, did they really?
Yeah, with it was very weird. Or one of the weird things they did was they took scripts they already owned and just remade them. So they brought back Mission Impossible with the same scripts.
And did they really?
Yeah, they didn't have to. They were like, we have the scripts. Just do a new show, same scripts.
That's so crazy.
Because they're like, writer strike, it gets around the thing. It was crazy stuff like that.
Oh, I see, of course.
Yeah, I would still welcome that if they were using old scripts.
And, well, that would employ us as well. Like, it wouldn't be, you know, I mean, unless you're watching Celebrity, you know what I mean? Which is
Fit not, Club or whatever. Well, it's
exactly. And it's just a shame. It really is a shame. And we're the only people, I believe, we're the only nation on this level for sure that makes celebrities out of people that do nothing.
Yeah.
That do absolutely nothing.
Yeah, and that's
you don't have to have any talent now. Nope. And not that I'm making a huge generalization, that these people don't have talent that's right. It's their hidden talent.
Yeah. But it's who's willing to do this rather than what can they do or what, you know, why are we doing this?
Right.
And I, as someone who loves stories and you know, the shows that, you know, I watched growing up, like Twilight Zone's the one I always use as an example, because I feel like that show.
I love Twilight Zone.
It's a show that made us all better people.
Yes.
Because it taught us allegories and lessons, even if you didn't know what you're getting at.
It's like an Aesop fable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
but better.
Exactly. Yes. Right. A little more engaging.
Yes.
But you can't do that with these reality shows.
No.
There's no deeper meaning to take away from it other than humanity is doomed or something.
Exactly. Inherent in its very nature is that kind of umbrella. Yeah.
But the good thing, I think, is that the sort of arms race that's going on right now between all the streaming networks who just want to be the last man standing, so they're funding tons and tons and tons of shows, is that none of them are reality shows.
Right.
They're all scripted shows.
Yes, thank goodness.
Part of that being economics, because they're like, we can't really sell reality shows to other countries.
Right.
They don't care.
For a reason. Yes. Exactly. For a reason.
But I don't care why. They're still doing scripted shows, which is great. And that's why we're getting like Stranger Things and, you know, all these great shows on like Netflix. And like I loved, I just finished Castle Rock, the Stephen King show.
Oh, really?
Which they shot in Massachusetts.
Of course.
It's great, you know, and it's like, I miss this. We need more of this.
Yes.
And I think the networks are like, we don't understand what to do now.
Of course.
Because they've tried some miniseries. They've tried to bring back event television that didn't quite work for them. Yeah. And I think they're missing the fact that it's not the content as much as the model that they don't have.
Yes. So, yes. Very well put, actually.
So my hope is that will make them go, well, maybe the reality TV thing isn't working out. I don't know.
Well, you have an in with the parking gods, so I'm hoping you have an in with the TV gods.
Yes.
And you can put that out there.
That's my hope.
Like that.
Otherwise, I will take a TV show where cameras just follow me around as I park.
Yeah, right.
Like, we go to different cities.
You know, and that might be better, actually, than most of the dribble that's on television.
They're like, we're going to go to Atlanta. Can you find a space? Drive around for 20 minutes.
That's right.
Well, I'm going to try
it. And people would watch it.
They probably would.
People would watch it. I would. Well, first of all, I would watch it.
Well,
because I've met you and you seem very
thank
cool.
you very much.
Yes, so you have one person here and you don't have to slip me nothing.
No, we've already made our budget back at this point with the one person.
That's right.
Take the challenge.
I'll pay your fare.
Yes.
I'll pay your parking meters.
Can he find a space in this area? We don't know. It'll be like really low stakes Evel Knievel.
Do you know what? I just saw this show like happening in Manhattan where they just run. It's like a rat race.
Yeah.
Where you just put a camera in front of a television when people have to move from one side of the street to the other because of street cleaning.
Yeah.
There's our show. I'm sorry I said it now. Because I think we can make this work.
We'll timestamp this date and it's ours. We got it.
That's
we
right.
Got it.
We said it first. You heard it here first.
It's right here. We're just like, construction? No. You know, we could do it.
Exactly.
But yeah, these shows that have, they're more timeless when they're scripted because they, even a show set in the future, like Mann and Machine.
Yes, yes.
Because they're telling a story.
Yes.
And it's not finding a story or coaxing a story.
On people's misfortunes.
Yeah.
Or being, you know, not picked for the team.
Right.
And being ousted, you know.
It's hateful.
You're ousted out of the Forge. You know, I was just watching this in the background, something I had never seen is this, you know, people making knives.
Oh, yes. Forged in fire.
Living, so it was like, you know, you have to leave the Forge. And it was like, oh my gosh.
It's
like
will
this,
come.
You know, Lord of the Flies type thing where it's like, you're out.
You're dead.
It was really bad.
Yeah, it's...
I mean, and I take that back. It was inherently, it was the same stuff that you're seeing on television. It wasn't in itself bad. And actually, those people do have skill.
Yeah, that's
like, they do have, a skill. I don't have that skill.
That's a nice evolution in that it's still got that element of we're watching the people fail, but at least they're making something.
At least they're making something and they have skill. You know, Yeah. Who knows? Maybe that will be my next. Yeah, maybe yeah, that's what I want to do when I grow up.
Have you seen Nailed It?
Be on the Voice. No, I have not.
Nailed It is on Netflix, and it's a cooking show.
Uh-huh.
But it's based around people trying amateur cooks.
I think it's about making nails. Yes, from what I've
they
seen,
just hammer nails. Yeah, hammer nails. it's like this old house, but thumb. Much more. it's just people hitting hammers. If they can recreate like really complicated baked goods, and they just fail.
Really? But I would definitely win.
It's amazing though, because it's not mean spirited.
Goods.
The people are just having fun and they know their stuff is bad. So they're like, we need to recreate this, and they're like, I don't know. Like it's just everyone.
Oh, I want to be
fun.
On that show.
Oh, you'd love it.
I would do really
out.
Well.
You probably could
being
get on that.
Being that my whole family was in the theater, I never really and there my grandmother was an amazing, she could almost be a chef, if you will. My mother's an amazing cook, but by 9:30 at night, the last thing she wanted to do was like make a dinner or right. teach me how to cook. So I'm learning, but yeah, I could absolutely be on that show and do quite
and
well.
You're in Manhattan too, where there's like every good food on earth at all hours.
My cooker was my finger that dialed the number.
Yeah, what do you want? Is there a show or a movie or anything that best represents like the New York that feels like where you grew up? Like this is New York for me?
Oh my gosh, that's a really good question. I of course I can't think of one right now. The Warriors was definitely a good one. The Warriors was a good one, but I really can't think of that right
it's
now.
It's hard to because when I think of New York initially, not Warrior 80s 70s New York, I always think of like the real 50s like intellectual game shows, like What's My Line and I've Got a Secret, and it's Gore Vidal is arguing with someone.
Well, it's funny, one of my favorite movies, and I've definitely been you know quoted as saying so, but like His Girl Friday, like I like Hitchcock films of no, that wasn't a Hitchcock film, but I like those sorts of older films, but the kind of pace of His Girl Friday is certainly one that reminds me of New York, like
the overlapping dialogue.
The overlapping dialogue, yes. And in my gait itself, I've been told forever, like, slow down. Where are you? Where's the fire? And it's because you have a purpose in New York. You're walking with a purpose. You're walking with a sense of purpose.
That's the same, when I first came out here from Boston.
Right.
Everyone was so slow and nice.
Oh, sure.
I said to my wife, I go, we could conquer them.
Yeah, right.
They have no defenses. Like it was just.
Have no defenses.
Yeah, they're just. There's just that slower pace, and they will go, why are you talking so fast?
I know.
Like, this is normal speed.
I know. Or why are you yelling?
Yeah, that's
I'm
true.
Not yelling.
Yes.
Yeah, right.
I'm very happy.
Yeah, right.
I have a story to tell on stage sometimes, but an old boss I had was from Staten Island, and there was a pizza place near my work, and he wanted to go because the pizza looked like where he grew up. And he went to compliment the guy that owned the place, and it turned into an argument about who makes better meatballs.
That's a good one. Of course.
And it ended with him agreeing they were really good meatballs, but screaming.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, they're good. Yeah. They're good. I'm like, why are we fighting? I don't. He gave you free food that you liked, and we're angry.
Exactly.
I'm like, and that's the Northeast.
I said, thank you.
Yes, that's what the Northeast is.
It is.
So it's a culture change when you come out here, especially when you're 21. And
I'm always like, hurry up.
Yeah.
We're walking here.
Yeah.
But it's true. They don't have any defenses, and you can always tell people that are not from the, East Coast when they're in New York City, especially, and I'm sure you see the same thing in Boston where they're just taking their time.
Yeah.
They're actually looking in the store windows. There's such a thing as window shopping.
Yep.
They're just like taking their time, and it's like, move it.
You're like, it's not journey. It's destination. We got one to get to.
Exactly.
Stop enjoying life.
Exactly. That's right. Stop smelling the roses.
We got to hurry up and get somewhere we don't want to be.
That's right.
That's the Northeast. Hurrying up to go somewhere you don't want to be.
Very much so.
And so it's kind of refreshing out here where you're like, this is nice.
It is. Yeah,
this is nice.
I like it.
And so you did Mann and Machine, and that I think was like 9 or 10 episodes. It was kind of before its time. So,
yes.
Which I imagine that's always kind of devastating when the show is.
Well, very much so. We were actually on the set when Dick Wolf came, and I mean, poor baby. He was as shocked as we were is that the studio pulled the plug. They were like, you're not making these ratings. We're losing a ton of money. And so they really gave him the short end of the stick on that.
But if you look back at the ratings now, it was getting like 10 million people.
Yeah.
Which would be the number one show on television now times 100. Like, it would be so much. Because it was such a different world.
Yeah, absolutely. And but people, you know, they started to develop what was called like patience with films, like and television. For instance, like Cheers apparently didn't do very well in its first season.
Bottom one, it was in the bottom 10 of the first season, and that was Brendan Tartikoff because NBC was so in the gutter.
There's a name I haven't heard for a long time.
He saved that station.
That's right. That's right.
Network, and it was because they didn't have anything to lose.
That's
So Hill Street Blues also. Was got nothing. Cheers got nothing, and they let the shows grow and become something.
Right. Which what a concept, you know, is to actually have some patience to see how it pans out
instead of
like this, you know, instant gratification taking too long.
Halfway through the first episode airing, they're like, "We did a test, and precogs told us it's not going to go, so we're not doing it."
Yeah.
And the thing I miss too is that even shows that they weren't picking up, so like pilots, they would still air them.
Pilots, remember
they would,
that?
When they made pilots.
When they made, back
they
in
would,
the day.
They would air them either as a made-for-TV movie, which Witchblade started as one, kind of as a pilot, or
kind of, Witchblade was just supposed to be a movie.
Oh, that really? They weren't going to do a series?
No, not at all.
Oh, wow.
No, when we got like the highest summer ratings of any cable show ever or something.
Wow.
It was people were like, oh, it's such a shame, that which it was, but we got a whole 2 years out of what was just supposed to be a 3 week movie.
Right.
So it was
a pretty good gig.
It was really great.
I mean, that's how it kind of worked. Like they would do just a movie for TV.
Or
they would do, you know, we made an investment in this pilot, and even though we're not picking it up, we're going to package it together as the CBS comedy summer series and air
the ABC after school special.
So you would at least get to see them instead of, now they'll stop a series halfway through and then you'll never even see the shows that are shot.
Right. Well, that's what happened on, well, we just stopped immediate production, but it was like, you're finishing out this episode on Mann and Machine. We're finishing out this episode and that's it. And I was like, what does that even mean? But I didn't know what it meant because I was so new. But Esapatha Merkinson, she helped me a lot understand what that was about. She helped me so much.
Was South Beach was pretty soon after that, though.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was kind of like Universal, like all of a sudden everything happened at the same time. It was like, well, you got Dick wants to write the series for you, which was so flattering. And you also got John Woo's, because it was John
his Hard
Target.
Debut
was
his debut
American movie. So it was like, so I'm just going to tam-stipe Universal on my back. Like, I'm going to get that tattoo.
Yeah.
Kind of like, you know, in the drug gang world. Yes. It was like Universal across my...
You got to kill a guy or do a movie at a TV show at once to earn that tattoo.
Exactly. Yeah. Which was great.
Yeah.
I mean, which was great, but...
It seems like it's almost too much to... You don't have a second to sit and really contemplate it, though. It sounds like you're just going.
Yes, very much. Yes, very much so. Like, well, I still... Right now, you know, it's 2018, and I kind of looked up and I'm like, oh, I never had any, you know, I've never had any children or any, you know, so it's like, wow, what do I want to do when I grow up? Which has been great, which has been really wonderful. In terms of just being so, I've been very blessed.
Yeah.
I've been very blessed.
I mean, it's interesting where, like, Hard Target is, I love that. I mean, I'm a huge John Woo fan anyway. Yeah.
As was I. Hard Boiled.
Hard Boiled is so good.
So great.
We had a Shaw Brothers theater in Chinatown in Boston.
Uh-huh.
And it's now a parking garage. But they didn't tear it down. They just made it into a parking garage. It's really weird.
Really bizarre.
And I would go.
It's probably a very pretty parking garage.
It's a very pretty parking garage.
Yeah.
I would go and see
how
movies.
Would you know? You can park wherever you want.
Wherever you can.
Yeah, right.
I get the parking. I never have to use the garage.
That's right.
But I would go watch all these Hong Kong movies in Cantonese. I have no idea what they're saying. But you could just go and there were nothing like that on screen. So I saw Hard Boiled there. I saw the killer there.
Killers.
And so I was really excited that he was doing a movie here. And it lived up to what I was hoping.
It did, didn't it? It was like me and 200 men.
Yes.
It was great. And Casey, who she was in for like 2 days, and I was like, oh, another female.
Yes.
Like, I bonded with her way more. Like, I almost sat on her lap. I was so happy
Please don't leave.
So happy to see somebody
with
estrogen.
It was in New Orleans, right? Was it in New Orleans?
It was in New Orleans, yeah.
Which has got to be a difficult place to shoot anyway, because it's 1,000 degrees and 200% humidity.
It was really, we waited till it was a little cooler, but when we were in the bayou, like, it was a hard shoot. It was a really hard shoot.
How was John Woo? Because he
was great.
I mean, he'd been directing for 20 years already.
Yes.
But it's still kind of almost his first movie in a lot of ways.
Yeah. Well, what's and because of that, and I always tell this story, he, you know, the studio, Universal, was like breathing down his neck, as I can understand, but a lot of money was being poured into this film, like a lot.
This was probably the height of Van Damme box office.
Yes.
It was like right after Time Cop.
Yes.
So they were, yeah, this was a big.
And I don't know where it falls in his order, but he's an amazing choreographer in himself, and people just see him, but he's an amazing dancer and choreographer. And John Woo is a choreographer with the cameras. I mean, it was just like we had 5-6 cameras going on at once. It was insane.
Which now people do in action theaters.
Yes, they
but
do.
But that was all new. Like, it's,
oh, yeah.
It's amazing to see
having another camera was new.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, you can do more than one. Like, all the influence of the Hong Kong people that came over here in the 90s.
Yes.
That's now the standard for stunts and stuff. That was really the beginning of that.
It was. It really was. And what John did is because he had a, I forget his name, but it was Terrence. He had a great translator who was also a producer. And he would like have selective understanding of English. Like people just like, he was like, you know, the studio would tell him to do something and he would just shake his head. And Terrence would be like, there's no word for that in, you know, Chinese. Yeah. Sorry. Like, can't not do at it. All. Yeah, yep. Can't do that.
We don't even have that concept.
Like, literally, can't do it. Yeah, it pretty much so. And it was perfect because I would just laugh because I knew exactly that he knew. You know, you got to know on a four-month shoot, you pretty much got to know somebody pretty well when you're spending, you know, 13 hours a day with him. But it was hysterical. I thought it was brilliant that he did that.
And that was your first movie, right? Was that your first movie?
That was my first. That was my I wish I could say it was my first movie. That was my first studio movie. Okay. My first movie was. And I say this with only because of the talent that was surrounding me. I did horribly in this film because I was so overwhelmed. And but it was called The Hit List, and it was with Jeff Fahey, who's an amazing actor, and Jeff Coburn.
James Coburn.
Who was so just given Streets those two? I was like, wah, I wish I could just like remove myself from that film. But that was my first major movie. Was definitely Hard Target.
Was it? I imagine Hard Target.
I'm talking solely about my performance. They were fantastic.
I'm sure it's better than you think it is.
I don't know if that's
true. Is it an
action
movie or is it more
like a drama?
I don't
know if
that's
true. It was a drama. It was, yeah. It was like what a movie of the week would have been back then. It's kind of crime oriented and stuff. But it was yeah, they were phenomenal. I was not.
Well,
Honey Boo Boo, Naked and Afraid.
It's Honey Boo Boo.
Yancy Butler.
But you're doing a movie with John Woo, and it's kind of a first big studio movie. It'd be hard not to know that's not how all movies are. Like, I feel like that would be an unusual set.
Well, going from that to my next film, if I remember correctly, was Dropzone.
Right.
I got very, very jaded.
John Badham. Yeah.
Yeah, he did an amazing job. And John directed. Yeah, it was a far cry from him, from Saturday Night Fever to that. So. But originally, as I've always told people, that my part in Dropzone was originally written for Mel Gibson, and they were going to have this buddyism film between Wesley, right?
You guys were always up for the same parts.
That's right. Honey Boo Boo, Mel Gibson, Yancy Butler. Yeah. And thank gosh, John Badham had the force. He was like, look, I let's not do another buddyism film. It's been done a million times.
Lethal Weapon.
Yeah. He was like, yeah, exactly. He's like, let's make this into a chick. And I love that they did not change the script once.
He's like a DEA agent or something, I think, right?
He played one. Wesley did.
Yes.
I'm always like a derelict or a cop. There's no like in between. I'm just like a total criminal or, yeah.
But I mean, the huge accent scenes in that movie, which you're literally dropping out of helicopters and airplanes and stuff.
It was crazy.
Which it looks like they had you do a fair amount of that stuff.
That was the first film too, where that was a lot of money because we had not only our usual stunt doubles, but we had jump doubles.
Oh, just for one thing.
Yes. Yeah, so we had like an A unit, B unit, and C unit. Like they had their own other film going where they would just jump out of a plane 6 times a day.
Yeah,
it's like
they do.
We're just gonna do that.
And
so.
Gary Busey.
Yes. Gary and villain. I are still friendly.
Gary's
I love
villain.
Gary.
Yeah.
Gary's the best.
He's huge in that movie.
He's great.
It's like pure. It's height of high level Busey.
Garyism. Busey.
He's
high
like a corrupt. I think he's a corrupt DEA agent that's like selling the names of
that's
undercover
right.
cops
he's,
and
yes,
stuff.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. And it was a great thing, but that's why Wesley clocks me in the head because he clocks me right upside the face because I deserved it. They did, you know, but it's funny. The studio actually, and they didn't show it, had Wesley and I kiss at the end of that film. And I was like, why are you doing that?
Yeah.
And Badham hated it. And Wesley and I were talking about it. We were like, isn't that amazing? You weren't going
to
have Mel and you kiss? Like, what the heck is
that
about?
Great if they were.
You know, it'd be that much more interesting. Yeah, right. Exactly. But you know what I mean? It was really like, and thank gosh they decided to cut that because it had nothing to do with the story at all, other than I'm a woman.
It
was ridiculous.
I'm surprised that they had the foresight to take it out.
Yes.
Because that's
right.
There's so many
movies that
seems like they if there's anything they can do wrong with a movie, the studio executives will do that.
Yes. Yeah, right. Pretty much. Yeah. And they did. And I don't know. I'm sure that Badham went to bat for that. Talk about rhyming. That Badham went to bat for that. that's my vocal exercise that I warmed up with on the way over here. Yeah. Badham went to bat. But I was amazed that they took it out as well. Thank gosh, because I'll kiss Wesley any day.
Yeah.
But no, it was really quite.
You got to film it. Though.
It was yes, we got to film it, and I'm a better
best
woman
of both
for it.
Worlds,
that's
right. There.
Right.
So it's these huge action flicks though, and I imagine the sets and the vibe are so much different than the other stuff you're doing. Even though I think right after that you did, was Brooklyn South right after?
Brooklyn South was pretty short after that. I did a couple of, because of those big budget pictures, I wanted to really give artists that were just starting out a chance. And I wanted to like relearn how to act. I was like, I've totally forgot. Because again, I never really studied that much. So I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. So I forgot, being from the theater where it's 7:59, like everybody's energy is all concentrated toward that 8 o'clock curtain. You know what I mean? And there's something that's so exciting about that.
Right.
And it's so compartmentalized with what I do. It's like I work and then, the grips work and then the camera guy.
Yeah. We
and then
shoot
it's
half
not
the
even,
scene here and cut it here.
Yeah. And Mike Nichols, God rest his soul, who was a dear friend of my family's, was like, he would sit in the editing room and he's like, now I can make a film.
Yeah.
Now I can make a film. And which was terrifying to hear and really great at the same time because so I really tried to give. So I did some sprinkling of that then. And then I did Brooklyn South mainly because it was an ensemble where I thought I'd get great, I'll work someday. No.
Yeah.
We were constantly on call.
All the time.
All the time.
Yeah.
I mean, there were 11 main characters.
It
was
a
lot.
It was a big show.
It was a PA's nightmare.
I bet.
Where it was like
everybody?
John Tenney's going up the stairs and Titus Welliver's going. Yeah, it was like crazy.
No, we need everyone now.
It was crazy.
But your point about the different styles of acting, I think people, and it's probably true to agree that acting is acting, but theater.
Yes.
You're doing a play or a show that's linear.
Yes.
That's all in one take, basically.
Yep.
And a movie is the exact opposite of that.
Exactly.
You don't shoot in order. You do it in pieces.
Yeah.
You
can mess up.
You can mess up. Which it's everything that it's not in theater, but it's the same function.
Yes.
And I can't think of anything else that's like that.
That's true. That's very interesting.
Even music, for the most part, playing live and in the studio is more or less the same.
Yeah.
You're not recording a song where you play the end first and then you cut in the middle and then it wouldn't make any sense.
It's interesting. And you said, and I meant to ask you this, you said you played, what did you play?
I did. I played guitar and screamed.
Oh, okay.
it was a punk rock band.
So does Honey Boo Boo, Naked and Afraid.
That's a good album. We started with bands like Dropkick Murphys and
that's
like
great.
That. Yeah.
That's great.
And then I realized that it was actually better to just do stand up and try to be intentionally funny.
Yeah, right.
But, so that's so weird to me because I can't think of another thing that works like that.
Yeah.
Nor
can I.
You as an actor are expected to be able to do both.
Right. Yeah. Yes.
But they're not the same.
No, at all. At all. Or then there's, voiceover work where that's, where it's kind of, but it's without, I'll tell you, and you must know more about this than I because I've done commercials, on television and your voice has to be awake.
Yeah.
Like there's no lying in your voice.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like I could be at work and I can be in my 18th hour, exhausted, but I can kind of turn it on with my expressions or something. Whereas my voice is like this and I can't, which is really difficult.
It's very, when you take away that visual.
Yes.
It's really hard.
Yeah, it is.
And even voiceover, like the people I know that the few people who still have the sort of mid-century Mel Blanc sort of very technical ability, like people like Billy West or Tom Kenny.
Right.
And I've
heard of those. Yeah.
Yeah. They can do, they know like where in their head this thing is and this voice. And
yes.
And they can do conversations between three people at once.
Oh, yeah. That's crazy.
And that's a skill that most people don't have.
Right.
But on the other end of it, when I see a lot of these animated movies, I had Andrea Romano on, who casts a ton of like the DC animated shows.
Oh, that's great.
But she was
I would
like,
love to do more voiceover work. There's, I love that.
It's great. But you need. She goes. They do a lot of stunt casting where instead of hiring the person with the skill set, they'll hire a name.
Oh, okay.
But the problem is, the biggest thing you need to do with hiring a voiceover person is you need to hire someone who knows how to act.
Yes.
Because it's more actory than if they're on camera, to your point. Because
right.
They have to know how to do it because they've had the rest of their tools taken away from them.
Yes. Yes. Very much so. It's not like buy looks right. where you can, you know, get this. It's very difficult. And I remember.
Or do
yeah.
looping later.
I know.
It's the opposite. It's only yeah. the looping.
And thank gosh I do better at looping. I think because my father's a drummer and having that kind of rhythm in my, you know, he used to sing to me in the womb, like right. all this stuff where I think I seriously got rhythm. Thank goodness, because it's not a fun process.
Yeah. That's hard to do.
It is. I love it.
Is it just like satisfying to like hit it right?
Yes,
like
it's kind of very yeah. much so. I'm like, yeah. yes.
I did it. It's like a video game.
You're yes, like, I yes very move. Much yeah. very much so. Beep, beep.
Did you ever do music? Were you ever...
Like... No, this is my mother's voice.
Okay.
I can't play an instrument. I try to shy away. I sang when I was playing Charlotte and Charlotte's Web in theater and school, and I was in fourth grade, and Adam Horowitz of the Beastie Boys made fun of me because my voice cracked. He was in sixth grade and I had the biggest crush on him, and to this day I ran into him years later and he's like, "You're doing so well," and I was like, "Screw you, you yeah. made what yeah
I could have been Charlotte."
That's right.
Yeah, his father lives in the town over from me.
Oh, really?
He's real horror.
Adam's great. But yeah. Not only, it was like being on stage and being Carrie. Like all of a sudden everybody kaleidoscoped out and all I could see was, yeah, that's right. Well, they were, yeah. but they didn't really, but it was just Adam. And I think he probably was laughing at his friend next door, but I was like, wow.
That's the thing when you were a kid though.
Like, oh, sure. It shaped my entire experience.
Probably
it was my raison
d'être.
I can barely, yeah.
Well, I always
I'm scared of speaking in the mic now.
I always say another Boston thing is we could call so many Boston things fueled by spite, because it's like people have a thing like that
right.
and they'll be like, "I'm going to do this now because you left." And
yeah,
like,
yeah,
that's
right,
what motivates
yes.
people.
I think I've dated that person repeatedly.
Yes,
yes,
many of us have.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. I will get up every day and
that's
suffer
right.
through this as long
I
as it's one day more than
that's
you.
That's
like, why? That's what have you accomplished with
I
this?
I know, right.
But it's see that
other
again
than deep anger
seems to be a thing we develop in places that have very cold winters.
That's right. Well, yes. I remember Dick Wolf was like, I got the script and for one of the episodes, and it was like, you know, Eve sings my boyfriend's back, and I was like, no she doesn't. I was like, absolutely. So I was like, perfect, as a robot I can actually say these words,
yes,
and be like, my boyfriend's back and you're gonna be in trouble, and it worked.
I don't
but
understand
Dick was like, you're gonna sing, and I'm like, no I'm not. Yes you are. No you're not. Yes you are.
But you didn't try to
funny.
Do like a...
And I told him the story. He was dying laughing.
You didn't try to do like a... I don't think the character would do that.
Yeah, right. No, no, it's like straight up not singing. Adam yeah. Horowitz, Beastie Boys, huge crush. Walls came crashing down.
Yeah. Well, Adam Horowitz, thank you for putting her on the path.
Yeah, that's right.
Acting instead
that's,
of
that's
a
right.
musical career.
That's right.
But at some point, you're going to school with in Manhattan with people... You know, presumably like other people whose parents are in the industry or actors
sure.
or musicians are going to do huge
yeah.
things.
Who knew?
And
that
that's
got to yeah.
be strange too.
Yes.
Like where you see that sort of happen.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. It's like, you're just little out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they, I mean, by 86, they were already huge.
I know. Isn't that amazing? I recently, what was it, about a year and a half ago, I was doing a film in Ohio, and I went to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame,
yeah.
and I saw like, because seeing my dad's, they have a great setup there where they're like the house that your family built. So basically,
right.
here's like, you go to the gift store and it's like, here, buy whatever you want. I mean, to a certain degree. And they take you on this VIP tour. It was really great.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah. And yeah. they brought me to the vault and the vault. And it's Honey Boo Boo in the vault.
She lives
and it's, yeah. She's got kicked out of the
yep.
vault. And, but I got to see, like, it was right when David Bowie had passed and Prince had passed.
Yeah.
It was right then. And to see Prince's jacket, to, like, see the first guitar that David Bowie ever played with, I just burst into tears. It was, like, it was something else.
There's, in Brooklyn, in Queens, in Astoria, Queens, there's the Museum of the Moving Image.
I always wanted to go.
It's amazing.
Really?
But they
I bet
have
it is.
A standing Jim Henson exhibit.
Oh, wow.
First of all, as soon as I walked in, I just started crying.
Yeah, of course. I didn't even know I was.
But it was like Rolf was right there.
Right.
And it's Rolf. It's the actual Rolf.
Wow.
But they have all the stuff from Labyrinth. And so they have Bowie's costume and Bowie's notes and all this stuff.
Oh,
and
my gosh.
It was so weird to be in that proximity of
Yes.
He was wearing that.
Yes.
And there are few people left like that where even that have that thing where you get near something that was theirs and you kind of get that
you get like electrified. Yeah. You get like this electric charge. Yeah. I felt the same way because they were like and they told me how they had to match it with the video that in 1972 he had played like this big concert and they had to match the notches to authenticate it. And I was just like, oh my gosh, that's really wild.
Yeah. You've done like forensic music.
Pretty much so. Yeah. It was really amazing.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Were you seeing going to a lot of shows and stuff with your dad or seeing a lot of music as a kid?
My first concert was David Bowie.
Wow.
And then it was the Bee Gees.
Okay.
Of course, I was like, I don't remember how old I was, but
Saturday Night Fever, and then you work with
and
John
then I worked with that's right, and then I worked with John later. He said that he got rid of like 150 FUs in that film because they were ad-libbed. The studio was like, you can't say that many times, or like 300 and something, or he was left with that. It was very funny.
Shave the
F's.
Yeah, too many F's.
Yeah,
you can have 50. I have friends that work in TV now, and that they literally give them checklists like that, and they'll have a negotiation where it's like, you can do two shits or one fuck. And they'll be like, all right, well, what if we can do?
Oh, we can't say fuck.
Yeah, yes, we can swear.
Okay, there we go.
Yes, absolutely.
F's. Or I don't think I've ever said F's in my life.
Right. But they'll be like, you can say a goddamn. Four times,
right.
Or do one shit and two goddamns.
Are you kidding?
It's very, yeah, like they have this negotiation.
That's hysterical.
So some of them will be like, well, we really want to fuck here. We want to have that here because it's really important. So we have to take a shit out. And like they have to juggle this stuff.
That is one of the funniest.
It's ridiculous.
I've ever heard.
It doesn't matter. Like they have meetings after meetings about arguing for can't we have an extra shit or something.
Yeah, right. Yeah. At the end of the thing, got three goddamns. You got you one fuck in.
Man, I should have fought harder for that fuck. It would have really made the scene. It's like ridiculous.
That is so funny.
At the end of the day, like it doesn't matter.
Yeah, really, it doesn't. Yeah,
there's
it
no
just
one
doesn't matter.
That.
No, of course. That's
thank
hysterical.
God they didn't say one more fuck because I would have been offended.
Yeah, right.
Two was enough.
That's, like, that's right. We get your quota of fucks here.
Yes, it's just a weird formula.
That's
how they have that.
That is so funny.
I
love that.
A friend of ours was writing for a CBS show, and they were filming the Mary Tyler Moore studio in Studio City, and it was actually the day she died. We went
to
the taping.
Wow.
But we got bored, and we were just walking around the set while they were filming. But they had this like bar set. And the censor was sitting in there. And he's just a lawyer on his phone, bored. And I was talking to him, and I'm like, so you're the censor? He's like, yeah. I'm like, so do they give you like a book? Do you get a training? And he goes, no. Just pretty much mess up a bunch and then don't do it again.
You're right.
So it's like, you miss a bunch of stuff, and then they go, that again. And he goes, okay.
You're right.
Like, what a weird job. Like
that's
you,
so
yeah.
bizarre.
All those censorship things. Ed and Beatsonder wrote for SNL in the first five years. And the notes that they gave them, they couldn't say tits, but they could say tips, which sounds grosser.
Sound gross.
They would end up writing stuff.
You got saggy tips.
Yeah, like look at her tips. And she was like, it just sounds weird and grosser, but they were okay with that. And often we'd have to rewrite stuff that ended up sounding way dirtier than we meant it to be because we had to write around it. Yeah.
That's so bizarre.
And the center was like, perfect. That's much better.
Yeah. That's how bizarre is that?
Yeah. Which is not a problem with movies generally.
It does. No.
Yes.
Not generally.
Yes.
Thank gosh.
Was there, so after you did Brooklyn South, and I think there was just one season?
Just one season.
Okay.
Yeah. I've been lucky enough and that's why when you said pilot, I also realized that I don't think I've ever done a pilot.
Like wow.
Well, because I've worked with, Dick Wolf, you're going to give him whatever he wants.
Although he wasn't Dick Wolf when you did the shows with
him. That's true.
He was still kind of at the beginning
of the Dick
Wolf empire.
He wasn't like making
money
to sleep Dick Wolf.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. But still. And yeah, that is true. But then doing, Stephen Bochco, you're going to give him whatever he wants. So I was fortunate enough to like never, it wasn't like, there's a possibility that this may not get picked up. It's like, oh, it's getting picked up.
Right.
We don't know when we're going to cancel it.
You had the opposite of you accidentally did a pilot. with Witchblade.
Yeah, like, and with Witchblade.
We're not even hoping this. It was.
Yeah, I know. It was really wild. I remember when Ralph Hemaker called me, the director of that movie, hence the executive, producer and showrunner and writer on all of the subsequent Witchblades, and was like, "So they're thinking of doing this thing," and I was like, "Doing what?" And he's like, "Picking this up into a series," and I was like, "What up into a series?" And he was like, "Witchblade." I'm like, "Really?"
Yeah. It'd be like,
holy fuck.
They're like, I could say it two more times. Yeah, right. But that's what you're saying. Like, hey, Hard Target got picked up.
Right.
Like, what are you talking about? Yeah, it's going to be a series.
That's exactly what it was.
We're done with it.
That's exactly what it was. And it was rough because they wanted that movie every 8 days.
They wanted a movie every week, yeah.
Exactly, which was exhausting.
That was the first thing you did with that was an existing character, right?
So yes.
You kind of had
actually,
to.
Yes.
I mean, you still got to create the character a little bit because it was
very much
just
so.
Visual.
Yes.
But I imagine that's a little bit more intimidating where it's a character that exists outside of what you're doing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, it was. I'm just thinking. I'm like, oh, God,
did
yeah.
you get a stack of the comics or something? Or were you
no,
trying to
well,
avoid
it's
them?
Funny because originally Oliver Stone was attached and he wasn't by the time we started production, but Oliver Newman kind of had called me about this project with Dan Halstead, and Dan Halstead's an amazing guy. In any case, so they talked to me about it, I read, and they were like, they want you to come test, and I did that, and I got it, and then I opened up the comic, and I was like, oh my God, she's naked.
Yeah.
All possibly afraid.
Yes.
And not honey boo-boo.
A lot of tips.
That's a heck of a lot of tips. Yeah. That's right. So I was, yeah, it was, so you had to please these diehard fans.
They dialed it back quite a bit on the show.
Well, clearly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Clearly. Yeah. You would have to.
Yeah.
But I'm like, how am I going to carry a gun wearing a claw bra and fight crime?
Liquid metal.
Pretty much. Yeah. Let's gonna make that work. But other than Terminator 2, which had already been done, and I didn't see Linda, I didn't see her wearing that.
No, she had full clothes the whole time.
Yes,
but was that the first thing you did that had that level of like special effects involved? Because the stunts are
yes,
one thing, but
very much so.
And that is again a whole different thing.
Yeah, which a lot of it was taken care of. It was the first thing that I had done so much green screen for
because it was very CG heavy.
Very much so. Like, I just remember, like, fighting up in the air with Roger Daltrey. And I always tell people, like, the because it was just a movie, this blade, this glove that I had was not fit for my hand.
Right.
And so they never changed that the 3 years.
We already made
I'm
it.
Not kidding. They never changed it. And the thing was, like, literally out to here. It was, like, twice the size of my fingers. So we, like, duct taped it. It was hard. I mean, it was really bad.
Yeah.
So the next thing I know, I'm up in a green screen with Roger Daltrey. And I, like, do some movement. And it, like, almost decapitated. He's like, she's going to fucking decapitate me. I mean, it was horrible. And,
how did Roger Daltrey
and we still
die?
Didn't. I know. Can you imagine? Trivia pursuit question.
It's a pretty good thing to have in here.
That's true. I killed Roger Daltrey. Two
Best
thumbs up.
Known for murdering Roger Daltrey.
Two gloves up. Yeah. But it was dangerous. But and it was that kind of thing. And plus, they had put me in something that was like really metal.
Yeah.
And
which is heavy.
It was very heavy and you can't like run down this, which they expected me to do. So it was. We were ill prepared for that show, to say the least. But man, it was a great show. It's still one of my favorites.
Had you met Roger Daltrey before that? Like, did you know your dad at all?
No. No, really? I didn't.
Yeah.
Roger's so wonderful.
It's
what
funny.
An underestimated actor. He's amazing.
I was going to say, his acting career doesn't really get talked about a lot.
At all. And it should.
Done
he's
a
incredible.
Ton. Yeah.
I know. He really has. And rightfully so.
Yeah. I mean, from Quadrophenia
and Tommy. He had such a good time on our show that he came back and he had written a song that specifically for the opening credits, and we never used them, and I never understood that. Like, if Roger's just going to, like, improv. Yeah. Annie Lennox had written a song, like, about my character, and we didn't add that, but like people were just giving us music. They were like Peter Gabriel. They were like, oh, we just love this show. And I knew once, and sign of the times, once the DVD came out, we didn't have the rights if the DVD came out, so we had to go back and change that music, which was just ridiculous.
It's always weird, like the WKRP DVDs that came out, they had to change all the music.
That's
which
right.
I'm like, this is
Venus
just
Flytrap.
Silly.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Because now we have like some generic Casio keyboard thing after Venus Flytrap. Like, here's the Clash.
I know. Yeah.
Like,
I know.
Like, no, we know. Like, that's extra bad. We know what it's supposed to be because he just told us.
Yes. Right. Exactly.
You know, it's but you know, when you're doing those stuff, they didn't know about DVD or
no,
they,
of course
they
not.
Just didn't write it in the contract.
Yeah.
And, it's if the choices not having it at all, or just having music changed, you deal with it.
Yes.
But at the same time,
no, but we didn't have it. We didn't really have a clue. So,
it's, do you watch the things you're in?
I do, but do you know I still have not, mainly because it doesn't bother me. I'm so divorced from it that, you know, I go, oh, I could have done that differently or even better sometimes, or oh, I really wish they had used this take on that. But I'm not like, oh my God, yeah,
I'm horrified.
Yeah, which thank gosh. In during some hit list, I was yeah, it was. I'm usually okay with watching that kind of stuff, but I have not seen all of the Witchblades.
Can you get lost in it? Like, can you enjoy the story, or you just can and watch it?
Well, it's hard to without memories,
right?
You know what I mean. Right. You're almost like, oh my gosh, we were laughing because all we did on Witchblade was laugh. Like all our job, our whole reason, our whole raison d'être was to make each other laugh off camera,
right?
Which we did all the time,
right?
To the point where, yeah, we would have to be separated.
So you're like, oh, I remember that day. This thing happened.
Yeah, Ralph would come down to the set and like set, and that was the last call. You know when the executive producer is like being called to the set that you're in trouble, which would make us laugh harder. Yeah, yeah, it would be.
It's like the vice principal exactly what yelling at a,
and he hated doing it too. But he's like, guys, come on,
time is money.
Yeah, one time I had to go to my trailer, and one of the other actors had to go to their trailer. We like literally got separated, which makes you laugh even harder.
Yeah,
it's like you're in church or something.
I'm gonna turn this show around.
That's right.
If we, if you kids. Don't stop
this. That's right. Yeah. Don't make me call the parking guys.
Exactly. But I mean, that's evident in that show that everybody got along together.
Oh my gosh.
As an ensemble. Still,
yeah.
And that comes through.
Me and
through.
The boys. My boys, they were great. They were great. But I again, actually just finished with, doing a film with David.
Another show with all women.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, with all men. No,
with
women
all men.
On the set,
I know. I know. It's usually, well, that's hence my life. It's kind of me and the boys, which is great. I mean, which is great. But I just finished doing a film called Emerald Run where David was playing my, David Chokichi was playing my husband, and Eric Atabari did an amazing job directing. I'm so proud of him.
Yeah. It's cool to have be able to like to work again with these same people that you had this chemistry with the ensemble.
It's the best. I mean, it's been 18 years since we first. I mean, well, David and I did a film together, but when we first all met, it was you know 18 years ago. So you really did. I know. I know.
Trust me, I know.
I know. It's like I know.
But you were saying before we were recording, you don't really watch anything now because you
no.
And did you watch stuff growing up? Like, were you a TV watcher? Or?
I did.
Yeah.
I watched Happy Days.
Right.
I watched, which I loved. I had a huge, you know, who didn't have a crush on Chachi? I had a, but you know, oh, Joni loved Chachi. Chachi loved Joni. So, you know, that'll make you weep. But no, Mork and Mindy, as I mentioned, I watched, it was all like, you know, but even.
The Gary Marshall sort of kids.
Yeah,
shows.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Which were great.
But I know, like, a lot of people I know grew up in major cities or grew up in Manhattan especially, a lot of times they wouldn't watch TV because they're like, I'm in Manhattan.
Right. You know yeah, right. Like, yeah, why would I watch? Like, yeah. This is.
I can go down to Broadway and see the first half of a show. Or,
yeah.
You know,
well, as my mother always says, it's exactly it. Yes, that too. And but, you know, here you have to drive in order, like, to go someplace to make it happen. Whereas New York, you just, like, stepped outside your door and it was already happening.
Right.
So that's true.
You're like, I'm sitting inside watching a show about New York.
Yeah.
I'm in New York.
Exactly.
Because that's where I mean, so many shows were set, like, you know, Barney Miller, Night Court, like these shows I would watch that were set in New York. It'd be so weird to just be watching them there and be like, why am I bothering to watch this?
Yes.
So a lot. So that makes sense.
Yeah.
That you would kind of watch the stuff that's very not New York-y, for example.
Right.
You know, Happy Days is in somewhere in the Midwest. And, you know, Laverne and Shirley, I forget where they were.
Yeah.
Someplace.
I love Laverne and Shirley.
But a lot of comedies, and you're very funny.
They were in Milwaukee.
That's right. Because the beer thing.
Yeah.
But you haven't done a ton of comedy stuff.
No. And you know what's so funny? I remember having a manager that was like, you're hysterical. But all as I said, derelicts are cops, and I'm always like, you know, freeze.
Yeah.
So that's not funny. So, you know, they're like, well, she never smiles in any of her stuff.
I'm murdering people.
I am murdering people here. So, people just don't think that's not true. They haven't met me, and they don't see me in, like, a comedic thing, which I would love to do comedy.
Yeah, like, that's surprising
to me. I would love to do comedy.
Like, it inherently comes across, and the timing thing, again, is a big part of it.
Right.
Because you kind of have that or you don't.
Right.
And that makes it so
Well, being from
surprising.
Somebody who does stand-up comic, thank you for even noticing.
You're quite welcome. Yeah.
I appreciate it.
That's everything. It's music and timing and comedy is very similar. So it's like, you know, it's funny to me that you're just, I was thinking about things I've seen you. And I'm like, I haven't seen Yancy in comedies. I feel like I should have.
Thank you. No, people, I don't know. They just don't see me in that sort of, you know.
Did you ever go
from your lips
for that
to the
stuff?
Casting?
Well,
guys.
Yeah, that's true. We'll write a role in the parking karma show.
That's right.
But were you trying
I'll
to
just
go
be standing there with cones and directing traffic?
Did you try to go for those kind of roles, or and your manager was just like, no?
No. My manager would have loved at the time to have done that.
Yeah.
But no, I think that just I you know, it's so funny. Once that happened with Mann and Machine, I just got typecast as this woman that could like kick ass and take names. And right. I never trained for that.
Yeah, you're not a martial artist.
At all. So, you know, I think that just, again, people are like, you know, we'd bring her in for comedy, but we're too scared. Well, she might kick our ass.
Yeah, we don't want to. That's if we laugh at her. Well, we know what happened to Adam Horowitz.
That's right. He failed miserably, obviously, in his career.
He might have spread the word and go, do not laugh at her, even if you're laughing with her. She really doesn't like that. And so people were like, okay, if Ad Rock tells us, we won't do it. But it's... Hollywood is very unimaginative in a lot of on the business side.
Yes,
in that
very much
they
so.
See you in a thing and they go, "That's the thing."
Yep, that's the exactly yeah. that's the thing.
Yep, they have to. Yeah. Someone else has to have done it before them. They think of it.
Yes.
So
yes.
If someone had done that and you were in a comedy, they go, "Oh yeah, she does comedy."
Yeah.
But they don't want to be the first one to do that.
No. Nor do, you know, that I regret. And I also regret not taking Dick Wolf up on. I remember he had offered me to, he's like, so you ever want to direct one of these South Beaches? And I was like, no. But yeah. I was 22 years old. And yeah. I really wish I had done that.
Yeah.
And I think that that's definitely something I could do now. But I don't see somebody taking a chance on a first time direct. You know,
right.
And not that I haven't done some of that. I just never got a credit
right.
for that. So,
but it's the cool thing now is that, like, you know, with the show, and I always say that this is like my teenage punk rock ethos come to life, where it's like, for minimal technological investment, I can do a professional show that's on the virtual shelf right next to $1 million things.
Yes.
And it's the same with movies where for, you know, you don't have to have access to film and $1 million and you can direct a short and you can direct something and kind of learn with like a pretty minimal risk now.
Right.
Which is kind of great.
Yes.
At the same time, it means there's a lot more of everything and a lot more bad stuff.
Right.
But.
But for the good stuff, it's. You know, it's definitely there.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, you can make a short.
That's
it's
true.
Simple and direct.
That is true.
But it's, yeah, 22, no one wants to direct. That's like someone going, do you want to write an essay?
Well, already, yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
I wish I did that.
But it was also, I mean, you know, the nature of the beast. I mean, our episodic television, action television, is just so hard. I mean, I never have worked less on those than a 14-hour day.
Yeah.
You know, it's... on Witchblade, especially, what was really hard is because we were doing it in Toronto, they were flying me, well, internationally, if you will. It's the easiest of the internationals, but and cross country to do photo shoots over the weekend. So it was just, it was a grueling.
No days off.
Yeah. And as I always kid around in the press, you know, I wasn't the star of the show, the Witchblade was, but it was on my wrist. So
yes.
It went, I went, and it was in
ill-fitting.
Every frame of everything, you know?
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. So it's, it was very difficult.
So, and someone had gone from these ensembles too, to now being the,
right.
The focal point.
Right.
Since the Witchblade's the star, you can be the focal point.
Right. Yes, exactly.
You know,
exactly.
That's a big jump.
Yes.
I imagine, yeah. Even though Brooklyn South was a big cast, but you're still in all the scenes and stuff.
Yes, pretty much. And then certainly with, you know, having, but I was always with a co-star for South Beach but I was also younger when I did those. But it was a lot. It was a lot, but it was great. It was a great show.
So you don't watch...
Anything
we want
to do a remake of it. We want to come
South
back.
Beach?
I was talking about, of
Brooklyn South?
Of Witchblade.
Oh, for Witchblade.
Yeah.
I don't see why
I
couldn't.
I know.
I mean, especially with all the streaming and the continuation series. Where are these characters 18 years later?
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think it'd be really cool.
She gave up the Witchblade and has
That's
to
right.
get it again and is like, I don't want to do that.
That's
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
I think that'd be really cool.
Getting the old band back together.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Yeah.
Maybe we get Roger Daltrey.
Why not? He would do it in a heartbeat. I'm sure he would. He loved it.
Can use the song.
Yes. Yes, finally.
Yes,
finally.
I've been having this in a box for 20 years.
That's right.
Well, thank you so much for doing this.
Of course.
Great to talk to you.
It's been great to talk with you. I loved it. This was so much fun.
Oh, thank you. And, we'll
and we didn't get to any of these fabulous This is really wonderful.
Yeah, we got a whole spread here. We got
I'll have to come back.
Muhammad Ali's acting debut in 1979.
Oh, my gosh. What was that?
It was a made-for-TV movie about like one of the first freed slaves who became like a gentleman in the Northeast, and Muhammad Ali starred it.
Oh my god!
Totally forgotten movie.
I bet.
Made for TV movie.
I didn't even know that they had it.
Really?
But no,
good movie.
I would love to come back and be able to do these. This would be great.
Oh yeah, we'll do it again sometime.
Great.
Thank you.
Ken, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank
this
you.
This was really fun. Thanks.
There you go, Yancy Butler. How great is she? As I said, super smart, funny, great stories. Book her in some comedies, everybody who books things. You will not be disappointed. I will put links up to all her social media stuff. You should follow her on Instagram, on Facebook, on Twitter, and all those sorts of things. You can also follow me or the show on all those things. The show is at TV Guidance on Instagram and Twitter. I am at Kenneth W. Reed. So you can search on Facebook, TV Guidance Counselor, or Ken Reed Comedian. They are all also up on iCanRead.com, which is my stand-up comedy page, or TVGuidanceCounselor.com. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or canandicanread.com. Also, thank you so much for those of you who contribute to the Patreon. That is patreon.com/tvguidancecounselor, because you help fund my trips to California to go and interview great people like Yancy. So thank you again. If you'd like to go there and contribute, I would be very appreciative, although I don't even think that's a word. Appreciative, not appreciative. I'm just going to go down a rabbit hole of pronunciation here. So be sure that you come back next time, because we'll have a brand new show. I have a great guest next week as well. And subscribe to the show if you can on iTunes or Stitcher or wherever you subscribe to podcasts. And while you're there, why not leave a review? Whatever you think of the show, it is a huge help if you review the show. It goes through their algorithms. It's far too complex for me to get into, mostly because I don't understand it. But I do know that it helps get the word out about the show. Thanks again for listening, and we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counseling.
We can say fuck.
Yeah, yes, we can swear.
There we go.
Yes, absolutely.
Fs. I don't think I've ever said Fs in my life.